Hi there, everyone, and welcome to The Daily Gardener. And thank you for listening. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling. It's January 19th. Today, we celebrate the self-taught botanist who saved the San Francisco Herbarium. And we'll also learn about the woman who helped describe the flora of Yosemite. We'll hear a little passage about the magic of light. And we grow that garden library with a magnificent new book by a modern plant master, Dan Hinckley. And then we'll wrap things up with a sudsy state flower found in New Mexico. Now, before we get to all of that, I wanted to take a quick second to tell you about two ways that you can connect with the show. The first one is a website called Podchaser. And if you head on over to Podchaser, you'll notice it's a brand new podcast directory, and it's set up to help you make finding and reviewing podcasts easier than ever. In fact, if you like a particular episode, you can even rate an individual episode as opposed to rating an entire program. So that's a cool new feature. And you can find The Daily Gardener on Podchaser. And if you do, I would absolutely love it if you could take a few moments and leave a review for the show. Compared to so many other podcasts out there, I think The Daily Gardener has a little bit of catching up to do. I think we have about 10 reviews, and I'd like to see that number grow just a little bit more, in the hopes that people who like botanical history, botanical literature, and just gardening in general can hopefully find the show. So if you love the show, I would really appreciate a review from you, and you can do that over at podchaser.com. Next, I'd like to encourage you to sign up for the Daily Gardener Friday newsletter. It's a fun little email that you can receive from me every Friday. And you know, it's a lovely way for me to connect with you, the listeners of the show. So I try to make the newsletter like you're getting a little note from a garden friend. I share what's going on in my garden world, along with fun ideas and products that I'm excited about, as well as many of the kind of things that I talk about on the show during the week, like botanical history and literature. So if you'd like to get a little garden note from me on Fridays, just head on over to the website for the show, thedailygardener.org, and sign up for the free Friday newsletter today. Here's today's curated news. Today's curated news was written by Andrea Beck over at Better Homes and Gardens, and I loved the topic of her article. It's called Three Gorgeous Ways to Group Containers Together for a Lush Patio Garden. You know, this is such a fantastic idea, especially if you don't have the room or the budget for a substantial piece of pottery on your property. So the idea of combining smaller pots, something that most gardeners have, is a great idea. And I think Andrea gives you some different options and things to consider, and just might help you think about your own containers in a new way for your garden in 2021. Now, if you would like to read Andrea's post for yourself, just search for the word container in the Facebook group for the show, and Andrea's post will pop right up. I try to make it super easy for you to find these great articles that I curate for the show by putting them in the Facebook group for listeners of the podcast. And if you're not in the group, it's completely free and easy to join. The next time you're on Facebook, just search for Daily Gardener Community, where you'd search for a friend and request to join. I'd love to meet you in the group. Here's today's brevities. Today is the birthday of one of our botanical greats, Alice Eastwood, who was born on this day, January 19th, in 1859. A self-taught botanist, Alice is remembered for saving almost 1,500 specimens from a burning building following the San Francisco earthquake in 1906. Afterward, Alice wrote about the specimens that didn't make it. She said, "I do not feel the loss to be mine, but it is a great loss to the scientific world and an irreparable loss to California. My own destroyed work, I do not lament, for it was a joy to me while I did it, and I can still have the same joy in starting it again." She was a faithful steward to the state of California. And there was a marvelous account of Alice's heroics recorded by Carola DeRoy, who wrote, "On the day of the 1906 earthquake, Alice Eastwood, curator of botany at the California Academy of Sciences, rushed straight into the ruins of downtown San Francisco as a firestorm swept toward her beloved Academy building. Arriving to find the stone steps dangerously crumbled, she and a friend nevertheless climbed the metal spiral staircase to the sixth floor with a single-minded mission to rescue what she could of the largest botanical collection in the western United States, her life's work." Eastwood saved 1,497 plant specimens from the Academy, but lost the remainder of the collections to the all-consuming fire. And just 3 days later, she joined the geologist G.K. Gilbert to inspect a fault trace resulting from the earthquake. And what I love about this article is that you will be able to see that moment where Alice was with Gilbert at the fault line, because it was memorialized forever in a captivating photo that features Alice standing next to the surface eruption of the fault line. You can find it easily if you Google it, and then this image pops up, and you'll appreciate the fact that that was taken just a few days after the quake hit. And Alice was 47 years old when the quake hit in 1906. After the fire, Alice set her mind to rebuilding the herbarium. And over the next four decades, she collected over 300,000 specimens. Alice retired as the curator at the age of 90. And Alice was the protege of the great botanist Kate Brandegee, one of my favorites. Now, when I was researching Alice, I stumbled on an article that was written by Dale DeBraxy. The article was a very poignant tribute to Alice. He wrote it in 2018, and he ended it this way. "In 1959, the California Academy of Sciences unveiled the Eastwood Hall of Botany, which is very nice. But I think the most fitting tribute is the naming of Eastwoodia elegans. There is only one species in the Eastwoodia genus, and it is a sunflower." And both of those facts match so well with everything we know of Alice Eastwood that nothing more need be said. And today is the birthday of the American suffragist, fern collector, botanist, professor, and author, Carlotta Case Hall, who was born on this day, January 19th, in 1880. Carlotta studied botany at the University of California, Berkeley, which is how she met her husband, the botanist and professor Harvey Monroe Hall. Later, Carlotta herself became an assistant professor of botany at Berkeley. Carlotta had a passion for collecting ferns, and she wrote about them as well. But today, Carlotta is remembered in the handy little illustrated guidebook on Yosemite that she co-wrote with her husband, Harvey. This pocket-sized botanical guidebook features over 900 species of plants and was called A Yosemite Flora. A 1912 book review said this, "For the lover of the great outdoors, who combines with his love of wandering a fondness for botanical research, this little book will prove a heyday companion. The book is bound in flexible sheep and is just the right size for pocket use. Today, a beautiful light green California fern, the tufted lace fern, or Carlotta Hall's lace fern, is named in Carlotta's honor. And if you'd like to take a look at the adorable little guidebook, A Yosemite Flora, I put a link to it in today's show notes. It's been digitized and it is so fun to look through. In Unearthed Words, today's words come from Marjorie Harris, one of my favorite garden writers, from her book, In the Garden. This is a little excerpt on her thoughts on the magic of light. In my climate, the hours of daylight are few, the number of sunny hours even fewer. We trudge through the gloom day after day, all through January and February. But when the sun does shine, it carries a magnificence unlike any other time. Perhaps our gratitude for light makes it so, but I think not. It's time to grow that garden library with today's book, Windcliff, by Daniel J. Hinckley. This book came out in 2020. It's a favorite of mine. It's really, really wonderful. And the subtitle is A Story of People, Plants, and Gardens. In this book, we learn about Windcliff, one of two magnificent gardens created by the plantsman, nurseryman, and plant hunter, Dan Hinckley. And in case you're wondering, Dan also created Heronswood. And here's what the publisher shared about Dan's book. These iconic gardens and the story of how one gave rise to the other are celebrated in Hinckley's deeply personal Windcliff. In a lively style that mingles audacious opinions on garden design with cautionary tales of planting missteps, Hinckley shares his infectious passion for plants. In these pages, you will love hearing about how Dan created Windcliff, from the exceptional plants that he selected to his pragmatic gardening advice. This book is 280 pages of creating a garden with a modern master who loves plants and is delighted to share his stunning garden with us. And you know how when you're on Facebook, they talk about these master classes all the time? Well, essentially, this book is Dan's master class on garden design. So don't miss it. You can get a copy of Windcliff by Daniel J. Hinckley and support the show using the Amazon link in today's show notes for around $20. Fantastic. Finally, here's something sweet to revive the little botanic spark in your heart. It was on this day, January 19th in 1925, that the Santa Fe, New Mexican published an article called Yucca Too Much, Like a Soap Ad, Wants Cosmos for State Flower. The article featured the opinion of a woman who wrote, "I object to the yucca as the state flower and want to correct the statement that the school children chose it because they really chose the cactus. Personally, I suggest the cosmos, now grown all over America because years ago, an old Spanish family in Albuquerque brought some seed from Spain, which was afterwards sent east, propagated, and distributed all over the country. The cosmos grows everywhere in New Mexico profusely, and so far as I know, has not been appropriated as a state flower by any other state. Well, today, the New Mexico state flower remains the yucca flower. And as hardy plants that thrive under trying conditions, yuccas are a common sight, especially across the lower elevations in New Mexico. The soap tree yucca, Yucca elata, is the most prevalent. A member of the agave family, yuccas are commonly known as Spanish bayonet, Adam's needle, and soapweed. And as a valuable plant to many native tribes of the American Southwest, all parts of the yucca plant were used by Native Americans. The pointy, sharp leaves were stripped into fibers for weaving, and the Apaches enjoyed eating the edible flower stalks and blooms. Most of all, the yucca root contains the compound saponin and is a natural source of soap. In addition to the yucca, there are several saponins or soap plants like the horse chestnut, the soap lily, the soap wort, and the fruit of the buffalo berry. Finally, the New Mexico State Legislature passed legislation making the yucca the official state flower of New Mexico on March 14, 1927. Thanks for listening to The Daily Gardener. And remember, for a happy, healthy life, garden every day. The Daily Gardener is produced in lovely Wyoming, Minnesota, with the help of Paige Mance, Brooke Bierbaum, Kiana Rayleigh, Maddie Doyle, Natalie Decker, and Eric Begay. You can find The Daily Gardener on all your favorite social media. You can follow the show on Instagram, and listeners always have a standing invitation to join the free Facebook group for the show. Just search for Daily Gardener Community the next time you're on Facebook and request to join. All the stories and books that are featured on the show can be found over at thedailygardener.org, thedailygardener.org. And while you're there, be sure to sign up for my free Friday newsletter. Last but not least, you can share your own gardener greetings on the show by emailing me at jennifer@thedailygardener.org. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling. And as always, have a great day in the garden, and we'll see you tomorrow.